Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This week's top eight is a special pre-release themed top eight. We do this one with every new set. First, we do the top eight limited bombs in Oath of the Gatewatch. So these, we're thinking, are the cards that you most want to open in your sealed pool this weekend at the pre-release.
Right.
We're not counting expeditions.
Yeah.
We're not considering the monetary value of the card, though if you open an expedition, good for you. We'll give that, you know, an honorable mention.
Yeah, Wasteland, honorable mention.
Yeah, yeah. Lucky you. Obviously, I'll never open one of those, but I probably won't open any of the eight cards on this list either.
Yeah.
Well, you have to open booster packs to open any of these cards, Andy.
Whoa. Don't give away the mystique that I never actually play Magic, you know? I'll be there diligently filming it for the
Look,
viewers.
You're filling in for Mashi. You've got to fulfill his role of not playing Magic also.
I'm going to assume that this was just a great plug for this weekend when I'll be broadcasting the pre-release for everybody to watch. The gunslinging that'll be happening there with... Are you gunslinging, Paul?
No, I have a baby shower to go
and,
to.
And you're not either, Raptor, are you? Or are you?
Wow, I wasn't even invited.
Oh.
Pretty rude.
Yeah. We'll have...
okay, I think it's going to be Martell and Nathan Holliday and
maybe
else.
Maybe Party, I don't know.
That sounds plausible.
Yeah.
It'll definitely be Tom Martell, and I'm definitely going to mic that guy because he loves to hear his own voice.
And Webb. Webb always shows up.
Oh, Webb, yeah. He'll be there. But yeah, we'll have Martell mic'd up. He'll be gunslinging, so he'll be playing some Oath of the Gatewatch Sealed, and he'll be playing some Standard and probably get, you know, dragged into some Commander games and stuff. So, you know, tune in and watch. There's all kinds of crazy stuff that goes on. We're going to kick off our top eight with number eight, Mina and Den Wildborn.
Yeah, so Mina and Den Wildborn, this card, you know, it's a card that, you know, if you're drafting like that aggressive red-green landfall deck, this card just seems like the perfect card for that type of deck. You know, obviously 4-mana 4/4 is just already, you know, pretty good body, but the fact that, you know, you can bounce lands, give a bunch of things, trample, and then also just trigger all their landfall just seems really, really powerful in that deck.
Yeah, this card seems like a heck of a beatdown. Yeah. You just turn a land to your hand and...
It's like return two lands. Play my. I have a Valak, turn three Valak Predator, turn four this guy, you know, play a land, bash, next turn return two lands, play two lands, bash for a billion.
Yeah, I mean, any card that encourages you to make sound effects while you're playing with it is probably going to make a top.
Yeah, bash! Yeah, exactly. Bam, bam! Bam, bam!
Number seven on the list is a card that we already talked about in the white section. We've got Munda's Vanguard. So this is the one where you can tap it and an untapped ally you control to put a +1/+1 counter on each creature you control. So, I don't know, Wrapter, it sounded like you were a little cool on this card. Would you put it at number seven? Is it overrated here on this list?
I certainly think Mina and Den is more powerful, yeah. It's just a bigger body to begin with, and instead of having to like wait and get +1 to your team, you can just spend 2 mana and give your team +1/+1.
Yeah. To be fair, I might have a slightly biased opinion of this card because I played exactly one match already in the 2-minute giant event,
and it was great. The results are in.
I guess the games are a little bit grindy in 2-minute giant, so you have bigger boards, so you know I have this giant squad. But yes, it was pretty fantastic in that match.
All right, number six on the list, we've got Eldrazi Displacer. It's a black card, Devoid 3/3.
It's a white card.
Oh, that's what I meant to say. This is the blinker. We went over this one too.
Right.
This should be easy.
God. Yeah.
This card's amazing. We already talked about all the reasons why it's great. Tap their creatures, blink your creatures, save them from removal, get a rebuy on their battlefield effects.
Yeah. Keep in mind,
this
it is...
This one's legit.
Yeah, it does cost 2 and a colorless, not white. There are not too many white spells that actually use the Eldrazi mana because they're all like... They're not really down with the Eldrazi or whatever, but this one card does actually is a white spell that uses the Eldrazi mana.
This is the perfect splash card, though, because if you don't draw your colored source, whatever, you have a 3-mana 3/3, still totally good card.
Worse,
and if you do, then it becomes very, like, very, very good.
Yeah, a perennial, just like fine card.
And this card is great.
All right, number five on the list, we've got Endbringer.
So I just pick all cards Raptor doesn't like and put it on the list.
So what you need to know about the way that we do these shows is that we go out of our way to not only not ask the special guest what they think, but we try to figure out what they might think and do the opposite.
So we have, you know, filler level 6 drop, ranked above 4-mana, 4/4, 2-mana, give your team +1/+1. Yeah.
But it's colorless, Raptor. You can play it in any deck.
I think the double ping is
pretty
good.
That's a color. You can't play it in your two-color deck.
That is true. It seems like a pretty sweet card. Look at the art on that thing, Wrapter. All right, anyways. No, I think this card is actually legit, though. I mean,
I'm going to have to say, I don't know what kind of sound effect to make with this one. I look at that art, and I don't know what to do.
It's not Bam Bam. I'll tell you that.
It brings the end of all things.
It seems like it would be one of those sound, like, kind clearly. Of electronic sounds,
it's just,
you know? Like
it's just emptiness. That is its sound.
If you have a Transformer sound effect,
Transformer sound effect
but,
for
sure. But,
you know,
sure. No human can generate that sound. That's kind of the point.
Yeah, yeah. Anyways, like I said, you know, this is the card that you play. You know, I just love the fact that you can just, you know, ping twice in one turn. You know, that's pretty sweet. It's got a lot of different abilities. The draw card might not happen too often unless you have a very, very dedicated deck. But the fact that he can attack and ping, I mean, I just like the utility of the card. You know, you have a lot of different little things you can do with the card.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think the double ping is, like, pretty key, so.
Yeah.
All right, number four on the list, we have Fall of the Titans. Great name. Apparently a great card.
Yeah. So Fall of the Titans, red XX. Fall of the Titans deals X damage to each of up to two target creatures and or players, and it is an instant. And you can also surge it, which, I mean, could come up.
So none of us have really gotten to play any games with Surge in a single-player environment.
Right.
How easy do you think it's going to be to trigger the Surge cost on your cards in general? How much are you going to try to focus on making that work? How relevant do you think Surge is in the 1v1 environment, a mechanic that was clearly made for Two-Headed Giant?
I mean, I guess a lot of it just depends on, like, the casting cost of the card. Like, certain cards are, you know, costed in a way where, like, you know, you can realistically pull it off. Like, this is a card that you're going to be looking to play in the late game anyways, right? This is a card that is going to lead to some blowouts, and if you set this up and you have, like, 7 mana, you know, you can, if you have, like, a 2-drop, you can play it, and then you can surge for 4, you know, and you're certainly getting more value out of that instead of just, like, you know, playing it for 3. I think you can set it up, but I don't know. I haven't played with it yet. So, you know, I imagine a lot of the time when you look at a Surge card, you just kind of, like, look at its face value, like, what it actually costs.
Right.
And, like, you know, a majority of the time, over 50% of the time, you're going to be casting it for that cost and not the Surge. That's what you need to treat the card instead of the upside of, well, if I play my 1-mana cantrip card and then Surge, that's game. That's not going to happen all that often.
I think realistically, though, you can play it in a low-curve aggressive deck where you just have a bunch of 2-drops, and you'll consistently have a 2-drop to turn on your Surge card on turn 4, and you can kind of evaluate them for their Surge cost more in that context.
Yeah, I do sort of wonder if there's a way to, like, I just wonder how many cards there might be that cost 1 mana that are, like, going to be playable, or
right.
2 mana that are good, or it'd be interesting to see, like, what you can do in the draft if you have more than one good Surge card to try right. to increase your chances of making the good side of the card happen.
Yeah, there's not that many, like, that's the thing. Like, you need the Surge cost to be pretty cheap. I think there's, like, the 3/3 flyer, for example, for that costs 5.
There's, like, Crush of Tentacles that's, like...
Yeah, that costs, like, a million mana.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think it's going to be kind of hard to pull off. But, like, a lot of the Surge cards are kind of decent on their own. They're, like, kind of...
Yeah.
Playable but medium, but if you surge it, they're good. So I think I like what they did with those cards. But yeah, anyways, back to the card. I mean, it's a 2-for-1. Instant speed as well. I mean, there's just a lot of value that you can get out of this card. I think this card's really strong.
All right. Yeah. At number 3, we have another red card. Chandra, Flamecaller. Now, Chandra's had a run before as a 6-mana Planeswalker, and it didn't go so well that time. But now she starts with 4 loyalty. You can plus her to put 2/3/1 red elemental creature tokens with haste on the battlefield. You have to exile them at the end of your turn. You can pay 0 loyalty to discard all the cards in your hand, then draw that many cards plus 1, and then minus X, she deals X damage to each creature. She seemed kind of incredible.
Yeah. That's because she
is. This card just kind of does it all, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, if you're ahead, you play it, and you just get to bash instantly. For 6, pick it up. And if you're behind, you get to, you're going to sweep the board. You know, sometimes it's just going to be a slice and dice. You know, just 4 damage to everything. If you have to, you'll lose a Chandra or whatever. But, you know, that was a bomb. That was a bomb back in the day.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
Well, 6 mana, deal 4 damage to all creatures is a great card.
Yeah, that's good. And then sometimes it's deal 3 damage to all creatures and you get to keep a Planeswalker around.
Exactly.
Yeah.
This card is pretty absurd.
That kind of
versatility
is great. Yeah. What do you think about this zero ability where you discard all the cards in your hand and draw that many cards plus one?
Just don't do it until...
It's a nice arena at the end.
Yeah, yeah. It's great. I mean, you know, you don't want to be using it too much when you have, like, five cards in your hand. You just deck yourself. But, but you know, the thing is, you know, once you cast all the good spells out of your hand, then you just, you know, you're always up a card. So, you know, you do get a lot of value from this.
I do think that generally you're going to be using the other abilities if they do anything. Like, if your opponent has creatures that can get sweeped without killing your stuff, you're going to do that. And if your opponent doesn't have big blockers back, you're just going to attack with the 3-1 haste because that's just going to kill them so quickly. There's not really any point in trying to draw cards and find something that's just going to be worse than hitting them for 6 that turn.
Yeah, I'm curious, actually. So do you guys think that this card will be any good in Constructed?
No.
Maybe as, like, a sideboard card?
How often has there been a Planeswalker that was, like, not a good Constructed card that... was like an insane limited bomb? How often has that been true for Planeswalkers? I think of like Soren from Zendikar. That was like a playable Constructed card. It wasn't like all over the place or anything, but it was good enough and obviously a complete bomb.
A Soren Markov?
Well, I think the only reason that's true is that they generally make the Planeswalkers good enough to be Constructed playable. So you just don't see very many Planeswalkers that don't pass that bar.
Yeah, I'm wondering if this is like the first one that was just like insane and limited, but somebody in the chat, really very good and constructed.
Somebody in the chat suggested Karn the Living Guild, Jace the Living Guild Pack, but that was not playable in very much in limited either.
Yeah, I was thinking
that card wasn't even that good in limited.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I mean, this card is like a certifiable bomb in limited.
Right,
and
right.
I would kind of be surprised if it saw play in constructed. I mean, someone will try, obviously, but if it has any success, I will be legitimately surprised. And
yep.
I don't know if I've seen that before with a
6 mana is a lot.
I don't think you can say the same of our next card. I think it'll meet both bars. The second best card in the format for limited is Nissa, Voice of Zendikar.
Three mana planeswalkers.
They tend to make the cut.
Yeah.
So you can. She starts with 3 loyalty plus 1. You put a 0/1 plant token into play. You -2 to put a +1/+1 creature counter on each creature you control, and you can do -7 to gain X life, draw X cards, where X is the number of lands you control.
I mean, it's a 3-mana planeswalker that protects itself. And then once you build your little army of plants or what have you, obviously you're playing other creatures, then you can just start pumping and making them bigger. Or if you don't have to do that, you just ultimate and, I mean, presumably win the game. You get to just draw like 6 cards and gain 6 life or whatever. I don't think the ultimate's going to happen that often, because once you do have a bunch of creatures, you're just going to start anthemizing your guys.
I see the ultimate coming up a lot.
Yeah,
it's really easy to just have... play this and you're just like blocking their creature every turn.
Yep.
And you just happen to end up at ultimate. Yep. Like most planeswalkers, by the time you get to ultimate, they've already taken over the game.
Right.
For this one, it's really easy, to get to the ultimate without having the game won already. And then you ultimate and it's just a game winning effect still.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. I can see that.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Is that it's so easy to script out what happens with this card. There's like one of two things. You play it on turn 3, which is so early. That's why those 3-mana planeswalkers are so good. There's not much going on the board at that point, but if they've got a creature and you play a plant, it's easy to imagine the situation where you go like plant, 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 and they're attacking you and they're trying to kill it and you're just keeping her alive, and you succeed in that. And every time you barely succeed, you're going to ultimate her. And that's going to happen in a lot of games where it's like you play her early and you succeed in holding them off, but it requires all your resources to do it, and then you use the ultimate.
I mean,
and then in the other games, you get ahead on board and then you just minus and...
Yeah, I can see how she could be a real nuisance for sure.
All right, well, I think the number one card is not going to be a surprise to anyone here. Linvala the Preserver is our best card in limited for Oath of the Gatewatch. We talked about this card earlier. It's so, so impactful on any game you played. And these cards where they catch you up from behind are the ones that really make a huge difference in limited, right? When you fall behind in limited, it's often a game of like just snowballing advantage and stuff like that. You know, like you draw a creature, they draw a creature, they kill your creature, you kill their creature, and then if they're ahead, then they're eventually just going to kill you. But Linvala puts you right back into any game where you're behind almost.
Yeah. Once again, this card is just absolutely absurd. We already talked about it earlier, and I mean, we're just kind of going over all the other cards. I guess the Planeswalkers are pretty powerful, but this is the card that, you know, when you're behind, it is just the trump card, right? You just get 8 power in the air along with, you know, 5 life. All of a sudden you can just, you know, you can come from a situation where you're behind and all of a sudden you're just starting to attack. You just attack back. You know, you just rumble, just battle, and you just win the game. And once, as Wrapper was saying, if you are a super head, you're still playing this giant dragon. I mean, you're just playing a dragon. So, I mean, it can't be anything else other than Linball at number one.
It's not a card that, like, you're ahead and it just, like, slams the door shut. You know, they could use a removal spell on it or whatever, but when you have a card that will take a game that you are definitely going to lose and change it into a game that you are probably going to win, those are the kind of effects that are the best in Limited, and that's why it's our number one card.
Yeah, that's the mark of, like, the bomb among bombs, is when they win you the games that, like, no other card in Magic could. This card is capable of doing that.
There's going to be a lot of cards, or there's going to be a lot of stories at the pre-release of people going like, well, everything seemed fine, and then they played Lunvala.
Yeah, yeah. You have your Dragonlord Silumgar, you have your Doomblast, you have your...
All right, that was our top eight Limited bombs in Oath of the Gatewatch. Enjoy your pre-release this weekend, and if you can't make it out, remember to check out our coverage of it on this very same channel. We'll see you next week on Magic TV. I'm Andy Cooper Faust for Paul Cheon, Josh Utter-Layton. We'll see you next time. Yeah.